All right, good morning, everybody. Let's try that again. Good morning, everybody. There we go. Just make sure I still have human beings alive out there in the audience. It's great to be here and get an aspect to continue to teach about the kingdom of God. Just a quick Coral update. She's not here again today. You know, she's got one more week of rest from her mild concussion she had in her soccer game. But I tell you one thing that really made me reflect on this week is I'm not for all the extremes that come along with some of the concussion protocols that are there. But I will tell you this, after playing football for over 12 years and all the time I use my head with reckless abandon and all the many times I've had a concussion, I'm very thankful to the grace of God that I use my mind in my profession and I'm using my mind right here with you. The only reason I can still do that is because despite me trying to destroy my own brain, that I can still use it. So it's another great testament of God's grace, and that's what we're going to look at. And we're going to look at some of these important aspects of God's grace that relate to God's kingdom. Amen? So let's go to God in prayer. Father in heaven, thank you so much just for this time together. Thank you for your amazing Holy Spirit. Father, we pray for your spirit right now to be the loudest voice in the room. Be the loudest voice from this pulpit between Frank and I. To be the loudest voice in the singing. To be the loudest voice inside the hearts and minds of those who have you. Father, that we bring our minds and hearts back in here to worship you and to connect with you and hear your word and cherish what we learn about it. Father, I pray that you move me out the way and that I can speak through it. We pray that Frank and I, that we don't add to or take anything away from your word, but that we may glorify you in your word and proudly proclaim the promises that you put out there, Father. We pray all this in your Son, Jesus Christ's name. Amen. All right, so we've been doing a series. We encourage you to go online and check those things out. We've been teaching about the kingdom for a few weeks, and we'll finish up next week. Will be the last one that we do. And, you know, what some of the snapshots that I want to encourage everybody with is, you know, because God's kingdom is so amazing and so dynamic and heavenly, and it has all these abstract concepts in it that you can never put into one little box, it's good to understand that we cannot easily define God's kingdom. We can describe it. And though all of God's wonder in his kingdom, despite the fact that we cannot define narrowly his kingdom, he made very clear how to enter it. You know, the secret things belong to God, but what is revealed, he gives to us. And he did reveal how to enter this dynamic and amazing kingdom. And that's what we're going to talk about a bit today. If you go to the first slide here, we are going to do a little bit of a recap. Because, you know, I'm going to handle some of the promises from the Old Testament perspective and kind of moving into some of the beginning of the New Testament. And then Frank's going to be able to finish up and cement everything in the next lesson. But what we know from the Old Testament is that, you know, when God was talking about his king for his kingdom, he talked about in Isaiah 11:12 that the Spirit of the Lord will rest on him. He also said in Isaiah 42, here's my servant whom I uphold, my chosen one in whom I delight, I will put my spirit on him. So here again, we got that consistency coming in about the spirit, right? So then what we also know in Matthew 3:16-17, that Jesus, to fulfill all righteousness, was baptized and the Holy Spirit descended upon him like a dove. Right? So we see this fulfillment of these things that were talked about in the Old Testament coming to fruition. And go to the next slide. So that kind of cements itself further because as you and I know, many of us in here are not Jewish. So it's kind of like, well, how do these Old Testament prophecies come into contact with me? Right? And that's where Galatians 3:14 comes in, where the blessings of Abraham, who will be a father of many nations, might come to the Gentiles through Jesus Christ so that by faith we might receive the promise of the Spirit. Below that are several other verses that have to deal with the Holy Spirit, it coming. They're definitely not an exhaustive list of all those verses. But it's just an abundance of information about God's plan, because anytime God was going to do something amazing, his Spirit was involved in it. It just takes a casual reading of the Old Testament to understand that every time God did awesome, his Spirit was involved in it. Right? Whether he was leading his people, calling his people to repentance, unifying his people, being creative, no matter what he was doing, his spirit was right in the middle of it. And although specific people were able to be given the Spirit in the Old Testament, here comes that foreshadowing that God says in His kingdom, He's going to pour it out on everybody. And I don't know about you, but that's an amazing gift. To think somebody like me, so unworthy, could have a piece of heaven inside me to help me along, encourage me, and to teach me and spur me along in the right way. Well, it's got to be a catch to that, doesn't it? You're going to give a heavenly gift that's so amazing. What does God want in return? Should be the next step of what we think about. You go to the next slide. So when we're talking about entering the kingdom, it's always good to revisit what the kingdom is, right? And although we can't narrowly define it, we can describe it a little bit. And we've talked about this a little bit on and off throughout, about how the kingdom, the Greek word for that is basileia, right? And what that means is reign and rule, and it's two sides of the same coin. Reign meaning the reign of God, which encompasses so much, but definitely includes us too, right? Reigning over us in our lives, and then rule. Because, see, the Jews always saw the kingdom of God coming as this big overthrow of society. And God talked about that happening. Now, that doesn't happen. That hasn't happened yet. But that's going to happen because God said it would. Right? So we have this here and then not yet aspect of the kingdom, where that rule comes in. And so we have all that bumbling together to describe the kingdom. And the people, the Jews, were eagerly awaiting the kingdom because they had been oppressed for centuries. Going back to the Assyrians and the Babylonians and now under the Roman rule at the time of this writing. So they had all this oppression to them. They were eagerly awaiting a new kingdom. Very countercultural to us, right? Countercultural to America, which is not awaiting a kingdom to arrive. More focused on sustaining. But when we talk about this and you look and you revisit what John the Baptist and Jesus talked about in regards to the kingdom, they both focused a lot on repentance. Jesus in his own words, it says in Mark 1:14-15, after John was put in prison, Jesus went into Galilee proclaiming the good news of God, that good news of the kingdom, right? And the kingdom of God has come near, repent and believe the good news. That might be an important word for us to flesh out a little bit if we're thinking about entering the kingdom, right? Repenting being an important aspect of entering the kingdom of God. So what does repent mean? Well, I have it up there. You may or may not be able to see it that well. But what it talks about, a Greek word for repent is metanoia, right? And what that means is a change of mind, a change of the inner man, with particular reference to the acceptance of the will of God. That's some fancy words there that all encompass a radical turning of your life. If I'm repenting of turning this way, I'm turning the opposite way. Right? An author, Ed Anton, wrote about this book, a book about it, and he called it a cosmic shift in your thinking. It turns your world upside down to repent. Because you go from being self-willed to the will of Christ. So turn over in your Bible there to Luke chapter 3. We're going to try and flesh that out a little bit more and talk about that. What exactly are some practicals of repentance? Because John the Baptist and Jesus were very adamant that before we can even enter the kingdom of God, there has to be repentance. There has to be a great change. And you know what gets watered down a lot in our society is what repentance means. Because it's not just feeling bad about what you did. Right? We all feel bad. I hope you do. I feel bad about a lot of different things that I've done. But that doesn't mean I've repented about it. Godly sorrow leads to some earnestness, some eagerness, some desire to see justice done. Godly sorrow means there's going to be a change in the way that we live. You know, there's a great song out now that my daughter and I get a kick out. I wish she was here. She would totally crack up about this. But Demi Lovato wrote a song, Baby, I'm Sorry. Not Sorry. Right? Which is the complete opposite of what we're getting at here, but it's so true for about society right now. Right? Because we think we can just casually, verbally communicate, well, I'm sorry then. while we're willfully, pridefully standing up strong in our hearts and opposing the grace and forgiveness that we really need to have for other people. And we're harboring the bitterness and the anger that fosters there that is directly contrary to what God has said that He wants. If God wants us to love our enemies, how are you doing with your relationships? Well, to enter the kingdom of God, it causes a radical shift in how you think about those relationships and about your enemies. But you know, we live in a society that wants to give God like top five recognition. Right? We don't really want to submit to God's will and His reign for number one, His lordship. Surrender in our lives saying, you have my career, you have my family, you have my life, you have it all. What is more popular in culture today is to let Him be maybe four or five. Right? I'm going to do my will with a little bit of God sprinkled in on the side. Right? I'll go do what I want to do, and because I'll go do what I think I need to do, and then God will bless that, because then I'll be able to come back, and then I'll go and be more giving to God and His people. So let's go back to the scriptures here and see how specific God is about calling people into His kingdom and what repentance really means. Luke chapter 3, starting in verse 3. If you got a little caption on the top of chapter 3, like my fancy little Bible here, it says, John the Baptist prepares the way. So verse 3, it says, He went into all the country around the Jordan, preaching a baptism of repentance for the forgiveness of sins, as it is written in the book of the words, Isaiah. Here's Isaiah coming up again, right? A voice of one calling in the wilderness, prepare the way for the Lord, make straight the path for Him. Every valley shall be filled in, every mountain and hill made low. The crooked road shall become straighter, and the rough way smooth, and all the people will see God's salvation. John said to the crowds coming out to be baptized by Him. Now remember, they didn't have cars. They didn't have subways. Some of these people walked hours, maybe days, to get to where they were going to be baptized at. So to walk all that way, John said to the crowds coming out to be baptized by Him, thank you for coming. You brood of vipers, who warned you to flee from the coming wrath, produce fruit in keeping with repentance. And do not begin to say to yourselves, we have Abraham as our father. For I tell you that out of these stones God can raise up children of Abraham. The axe is already at the root of the trees, and everyone that does not produce good fruit will be cut down and thrown into the fire. What should we do then? The crowd asked. John answered, anyone who has two shirts should share with the one who has none. Anyone who has food should do the same. Even tax collectors came out to be baptized. Teacher, they asked, what should we do? Do not collect any more than you are required to, he told them. Then some soldiers asked him, and what should we do? He replied, don't extort money and don't accuse people falsely. Be content with your pay. John the Baptist lays it out. And he challenges people to not have an external worship of God like the Pharisees did. Right? Because the Pharisees were the most religious people of that time. They went to church more than anybody. Right? They knew the Torah better than anybody. They knew the verses better than anybody. But they didn't allow the reign of God to rule within them from the inside out. And because they did not do that, they were not welcomed in to be baptized. They were called a brood of vipers. So here people start coming up and they're asking Him what to do, and He's giving specifics. And what I want to encourage you to think about, for those of you considering and taking in about God and whether or not you should enter into his kingdom, a part of that conversation has to be, have you looked at your life and asked yourself, what does Christ want me to repent of? Because he will tell you. I know for me, I had to really zero in on pride and lust, amongst other things. Right? So when they started studying the Bible with me, the first time they studied the Bible, they couldn't get through one verse before I argued them down so bad that they closed the Bible and said, you're not ready. Wow. I did not have the heart of a child ready to learn what my Heavenly Father was teaching. I was arrogant and prideful and argued the whole time. Tried to justify myself. Aside from a life that was so immoral and so lustful that it shamed God. Wow. That it hurt God. Wow. So when I was studying the Bible, I had to have a cosmic shift in my mind to say, I'm going to repent of this pride. And I'm going to be a learner. I'm going to stop having immoral relationships with women. I'm going to stop, and I'm going to cut this on the root when it regards to pornography, strip clubs, whatever it may be. I'm going to cut these things out of my life and repent and turn to God. Because that's what repentance means. You get the gift of the Holy Spirit later. You can repent on your own. You can look to God and cry out and repent and make a different decision. That is our responsibility as people. God is not asking too much from us to call us to repentance in his mighty kingdom. Turn over to Matthew 18 here while we close out. So when we look over here, Matthew 18, and we flesh out a little bit more of what we're talking about with pride, it would be Matthew 18, 1 through 4. Have you ever been in one of those conversations where you didn't expect it to get so heavy? Like, you kind of expected like an easy conversation, and then it just like, the whole conversation just dropped on your head into something much bigger. If you're married, you have a lot of those. And you just don't see them coming. And there's no way to not see them coming, right? But not just married people. I would argue that any relationship, if you have strong friendships and you're connected with people, that you get these huge, heavy conversations out of nowhere. Right? And if a good friend continues to love and listen. Well, I feel like that's the disciples at this time really didn't expect to get this heavy of a conversation from Jesus. So in Matthew 18, verse 1, it says, at that time the disciples came to Jesus and asked, who then is the greatest in the kingdom of heaven? He called a little child to them and placed the child among them. And he said, truly I tell you, unless you change and become like little children, you will never enter the kingdom of heaven. Therefore, whoever takes this lowly position of the child is greatest in the kingdom of heaven. Think about the magnitude of what Jesus just said right now. To his disciples. And how much God opposes pride. Yes. Yes. Excuse me, pride. Yes. How much he opposes pride. Yes. And that if we're going to enter the kingdom of God, we must repent. And we must have the teachable heart of a child. Yeah. Not only to enter, but to remain. Mm-hmm. Wow. And how much God values that humility. And that has always been an essential part of his kingdom. Yeah. That we repent and have the humility to make him Lord of our life and ask our Heavenly Father, your will be done. Yes. Your kingdom come. On earth as it is in heaven. Amen. To God be the glory. Amen. Amen. At this time, we're going to take a moment to pray for contribution. Father in heaven, you are an amazing God. You are an awesome God. In all the riches and wonders that you have stored up in your kingdom for those who